Welcome to the Ayanna Crawford Show Inside Excellence. Show Inside Excellence. Today we're dedicating our show to the men and women who fight for our freedom. As you might know, Memorial Day will be coming up soon, and I wanted to share with you a few famous veterans that have contributed to our society. In particular, Tony Bennett, who is a singer. He was a private in the U.S. Army. Clint Eastwood, an actor, director. He was a former instructor for the U.S. Army. Malcolm Forbes, you would have never guessed it. He was in the military as well. And Rocky Marciano, a heavyweight boxer, champion, former enlisted in the U.S. Army. Dave Thompson, founder and CEO of Wendy's, former state sergeant of the U.S. Army. Who would have guessed it? Those folks were part of our Army. And so today's show is going to be dedicated to our veterans. I am pleased and honored to have the most passionate and compassionate gentleman here with us today, Gumasindo Gomez, who is the Executive Director for the Veterans Affairs Outreach Centers here in Massachusetts. Let's please welcome Mr. Gomez to the Ayanna Crawford Show Inside Excellence. Welcome.
Well, thank you for having me. It's just a pleasure being on your show. Especially in such an occasion in celebrating this Memorial Day that attests to us the sacrifices of others for our freedom in the Constitution of this United States mm-hmm. of America.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So I wanted to first tell our audience a little bit about yourself and your passion and your commitment to the veterans here in Western Massachusetts.
Myself. Wow.
I know, that's a loaded question, but you know, I know you've got a lot to say to us.
And that's why I say myself. Myself is a history of 65 years. I was born in Puerto Rico in the little town of Sabana Grande. And from there I enlisted in the United States Army in 1966 through the state of New York City. And guess what? I ended up in Vietnam.
I hear all the stories about Vietnam, let me tell you.
But the funny thing is that I joined the Army not knowing that there was a war going on. And I didn't find out about the war until I arrived in basic training in Fort Dix, New Jersey June 1966. And our drill sergeant said, "Well, you suckers, you better get ready. You know why? Because you're not coming back." Coming back from where?
Right, Vietnam. And what year was that? Was
1966.
Yes, wow, that was a very political time, too.
Oh, yes, it was.
I mean, the civil rights movement was going on. You know, Malcolm X and Martin Luther King. There was lots of things that were going on during that time.
But me, dummy me, I did not know none of this. I just had come from Puerto Rico.
Sure,
And I was not very savvy in what was happening, specifically in the United States in this war in Vietnam.
Sure.
Well, needless to say, I ended up in Vietnam and did my tour of 1 year in the infantry with the 196 Light Infantry, and my good Lord allowed me to come back. And I liked it so much that I continued to enlist in the military, and I spent 20 years in the military, retiring back in 1986, and I came here to beautiful Springfield.
Yes, and it is. It's a beautiful Springfield. We've got lots of things going on in our city. So why don't you tell us a little bit about why you decided to really create this veteran center? And I know there's a lot of them out here in Springfield.
Well, I never told you why I came to Springfield either.
Right.
I came to Springfield because I trained the most beautiful woman out of Springfield. I fell in love with her. And she became my wife. And she brought me to Springfield. Now, I ended up here believing that retirement was it. Here I'm going to lay around and look funny for the rest of my life and wait for a paycheck that the Army's going to give me. Come to find out that that was not going to be enough. And I started looking around and seeing the Hispanic veterans and got to know them because I became a volunteer at the Federal Vet Center. And all these people started coming in, Hispanics that knew very, very little English. Especially those from Vietnam and the war in Korea and in between. Then I realized that there was nothing for the Hispanic veterans within Springfield. And that's when the idea came to mind that we needed to create an outreach center bilingual with cultural and individuals of that caliber to be able to take care of those individuals. And that's when I got to work and I created then the Puerto Rican Veterans Association with some veterans out of Boston. And that happened in August 17th, 1987, when the first outreach center was opened in Springfield. The first outreach center, because there was no other state outreach center then until that one came into place.
Interesting. 1987. I'm trying to remember where I was in 1987. I think I was about third, fourth grade. And I was going to a Catholic school then. So in 1987, that was a big time for me.
That was a big time. You're lucky. That's what I was going to say. You were in diapers.
No, I wasn't quite in diapers, but I was in third grade. And I went to actually Ursuline Academy. So that's where I was. I was studying to be who I am today, I guess.
Amen.
But that's exciting, though. So
it is because, you know, I have held two jobs in my life. My first job, of course, with the military, about 20 years. Service, and now this job, which I have held as the executive director of the Bilingual Veterans Outreach Centers of Massachusetts, centers in plural, because we have two. We have one in Boston and this one here in Springfield. And I've been here for 26 years directing the center. As when we started, when I started, I was a one-man operation. I was the executive director, I was the secretary, I was the treasurer, I was the case manager, I was everything.
Interesting. That is so interesting because that's how businesses start, right? You have to take on all those roles in order to really understand the inner workings of a business, correct? So that makes sense. I mean,
that wasn't the worst part of it. Very little money. And you're right, that is the way the business starts. But what happens in businesses like this that succeed, there has to be a heart into it.
Absolutely. And
you say about my patient or my passion for veterans and my patient.
Oh, that makes sense too, right? Because you're caring for them, you're helping them, you're healing them. You know, they may have been, you know, through what we call that post-traumatic stress syndrome. And so they're coming back here after the war. They need to know that they're loved and they're cared for and what services and what things that they can have and be able to take care of themselves and their family instead of feeling stigmatized after going out and fighting for our freedoms. You know, so when you talk about, you know, setting up these centers, I envision or I think about this idea that, you know, it's a center where folks can come and feel, you know, that they're cared for, that they're loved, and now there's resources available for them. There's job placement. And so I'm hoping that that's what this is all about. Is that correct?
That was what it's all about, but there is a certain sentiment that you have to put behind of that. My job in the military, my last job was that I was as a first sergeant. My responsibility was to ensure that the soldiers were ready to go into a mission. When the officer, company commander came up to me and said, "First Sergeant, are we ready to go?" "Sir, we're ready to go." And I better be sure that I was ready to go, that the soldiers had all their bullets and their beans and all the equipment that they needed. I took that attitude with this center. I kept my combat boots on, took off my uniform and my sentiments from them. I have to ensure that the veterans, after they serve, they have everything they deserve. And that is my job as executive director with my employees here. Mm-hmm. And that's why it means so much for mm-hmm. me mm-hmm. to ensure that those veterans are taken care of. Because one thing, while they're in uniform, we take them in, we abuse them, we kick them, we use them. Mm-hmm. Once we come out, we are a number, mm-hmm. a social security number. Mm-hmm. And many of us fall through the cracks if there is not somebody there to grab you by the hand and walk with you. You talk about PTSD. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And again, that is another factor mm-hmm. that I love this job, because the veterans are my medication. Mm-hmm. I have to self-medicate myself with them because I also suffered the PTSD syndrome. Mm-hmm. And by talking to them and finding out about their problems, I'm able to find myself also and really feel good for what I do. Mm-hmm. I went and graduated from Cambridge College mm-hmm. with a master's in counseling psychology mm-hmm. just to find myself in PTSD.
Sure,
and that
sure.
has helped me tremendously. Mm-hmm. And I had the opportunity to go to other jobs after mm-hmm. graduation mm-hmm. because they offered me the money that went along mm-hmm. with the career. But right. yet, I kept my $30,000 job then. I said, no, I'm gonna stay here. Not because of the money,
right,
but
right,
because
right.
of those veterans that I was serving.
Right, right.
And still serving.
You know, when we talk about the history of the Veterans Affairs Office, the national, right? So July 21st, 1930 is when the United States of America, the government, decided to create this Veterans Affairs Office. And so within that office, they decided that they wanted to make sure that there's funding available for veterans. And so they put together what the budget, the annual budget is $87.6 million. And that money is utilized throughout the nation for veterans, correct? And Eric, and you can help me out with his name.
Sinsicki.
Sinsicki is the general secretary for the Veterans Affairs Office. And the first time here in Western Mass or New England that veterans were cared for was in Plymouth Colony. And so I think this part of the country, Massachusetts, has had an opportunity to really help veterans, but I think more work is needed to be done. And so why don't you share some of the things that, I know you talked about the services that you provide, but really once someone comes back from combat, someone comes back from being out there in war times, what does that look like for them in terms of their services, what they're going to receive, what they're going to get, and in terms of their family, how's their family going to be taken care of? What does that really look like for someone like myself, a lay person that really may not have the real inner workings of what that looks like for a veteran, and at least for our audience too that's listening?
You touch on Massachusetts and being over there in Plymouth about the first institution to care for veterans. Mm. Massachusetts has lots of history in first, in wars, and in veterans. I don't know if the audience don't, but you know that Massachusetts veterans soldiers liberated Puerto Rico in 1998 of the Hispanics, and they were the ones who invaded the island to take over and bring it to the United States as a territory, mm-hmm. and that happens with General Miles out of Lilminster.
Okay.
And the ship that went to Puerto Rico in this invasion was USS Massachusetts.
Wow.
That's just a little piece of history.
That's some history that we need to be studying in our school system, let me tell you. Thank you so much for that information.
You know,
that's empowering.
Not too long ago, a few years back here in Westfield, they found a battalion banner from one of the battalions of Puerto Rico telling us
sure.
that a soldier from Westfield brought that banner from Puerto Rico, and they just found it about 3 or 4 years ago.
Wow.
And it's now back in the military museum in Puerto Rico. But again, in your question in how to deal with veterans.
Right. It's an important question.
It's very important because
Even for our audience that's kind of listening.
When we send our kids away.
Sure.
And we've grown up that kid in our home with all our customs, our good words, our good deeds, and we have done the best that we could to ensure that this kid not only males but females. And we send them, we give them to the United States of America. Here's my kid, he wants to volunteer to serve in the military. And when they come back, we say, who are you?
Right, right. That is so true, yeah.
Who are you? Right. I do not know you.
Right.
I have mothers and fathers that come here. They bring their kids over here and say, Gumercindo, I don't know my kid. I said, you're never going to know him from now on. You're never going to know. You know why? Because we veterans have the tendency not to tell everybody our affairs, what went on.
Right, while you're at wartime.
And only us veterans can share that information because we've been there, we've done that. And no other will understand. Nobody else, not mom. Mom, you will not understand as much as you want to try. Or pop, you will not understand.
Right.
Or sister or brother, you can't. You have not been there.
Right, right.
You need to be there. You need to have put on those combat boots and feel the pressure.
Right.
And feel the love between each other.
Right. So how can, you know, families really support those veterans? What do they do? What do they say? How can they do kind of like you're saying, even though we don't understand what went on during that wartime, but how do we as parents really help our children, help our family members understand what services or what things can be provided for them so that we can help them heal? Because like you talked about the PS, the post-traumatic stress, that's real. That's something that's real that we can't really understand. So how can we help them? How can we show that we love them but not forgetting that what they went through is private and confidential, but we want to help?
Education, you mentioned it. They need to be educated. The VA right now, through the Vet Center, Federal Vet Center here in Northgate Plaza, is offering that help to parents to come into conference and learn what PTSD, TBI and other symptoms are all about.
And TBI is?
Traumatic brain damage.
Traumatic brain damage. That's something that we hear about, but we don't hear too much information. I know it's the post-traumatic stress, but that is also a major concern too.
See, right now in this new wards where all these big explosions are happening, the brains of veterans are getting injured.
Okay.
When that explosion happens, and it hits that brain hits against the walls of the head, and it becomes damaged. What's that? That's what TBI is all about.
Okay.
And that creates sentiments close to what PTSD is, but they come about quicker than PTSD. PTSD can take time.
Right, sure.
So we need to, parents need to get this education.
Right.
Find places like this, go into the web, find where those individuals are at, and then contact us. Like I say, I have had quite a few contacting me.
Right.
Say, I need help.
Right, so folks that are listening or watching us, so the Veterans Affairs Office, the centers here in Springfield, and so why don't you give that address really quickly?
The Bilingual Veterans Outreach Centers.
Yes, the Bilingual Outreach Centers here in Mass.
And it's located at 281 Franklin Street here in Springfield.
Right, and that's a very important address. And why don't you just throw out the number too, just in case?
Of course, 413-731-0194. Also my email address, Sergeant Gomez, SGT Gomez at AOL.com. We also got a website that you can educate yourself through this website.
Oh, wonderful.
Which is bilingualvets.org.
Wonderful. And I've seen a Facebook page that was created too.
Of course. The man who is behind the camera with us today is the creator.
Yes.
Is the creator.
Yes.
And doing a wonderful job in getting this information out for the veterans.
Right. Yes, he is. Absolutely.
But again, mom and dad, you need to allow ourselves to deal with your sons and daughters.
Right.
Because we're veterans just like they are.
Right.
And they will talk to us. And we will do anything and everything that we must to ensure that they live not only a long life with all the benefits mm-hmm. that they deserve, but a life where they can be comfortable.
Right.
And be able to live with the monsters. Because PTSD is one thing that will never go away.
Mm-hmm.
PTSD will be there forever. But we can learn to live with it in a positive way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's the trick to PTSD. Taking all those symptoms and turning them around and making them positive and becoming a workaholic like I am.
Yeah, I hear about you everywhere I go. You know, you're very popular, well known in the city, do a lot of work. I know the city of Springfield, their veterans office is very connected with you. I know a lot of folks, like the state representative Ben Swan, has done some work with you. And so you're very, very connected. And it seems, again, that you have this major passion for veterans, and especially bilingual veterans. And I think that's a testament to who you are as a man and as a community leader. And that's wonderful. And so with all that being said, I wanted to find out from you specifically in terms of the establishment of not only the centers, but other things that are coming down the pipes for the veterans, other programs, other initiatives, or things that are happening currently right now. If you can talk a little bit about that.
Being that you mentioned that, I'm all over.
Yes.
I'm going to bring out some that we're working on now, which
sure.
is very, very important to the nation of Puerto Rico.
Okay, wonderful.
We had in the Korean War a regiment called the 65th Infantry Regiment. It was an all Puerto Rican regiment.
Okay.
And they were from the National Guard, and they sent this regiment to the war in Korea.
Okay.
Limit, if not, no English at all.
Hmm.
In the heart of winter, they arrive in Korea with summer closing.
Hmm.
They were given the most difficult and harsh missions to accomplish.
Hmm.
And yet the 65th Infantry Regiment of Puerto Rico came back as a hero unit.
Wow.
By itself.
That's
picked
amazing.
Picked up many, many awards, and yet it was forgotten. It was forgotten. In 1994, I commenced to work then with President Clinton to recognize that unit,
okay.
national level. Mm. And it did. And at present, we are working in getting Congress to present to this unit, to the small group that is left, probably 300, 500 of them are still alive.
Sure.
They're in between 80 to
sure.
90 years old.
Sure.
The Congressional Gold Medal.
Oh, that's amazing. That's one of the highest recognitions
that
you can get.
This is the highest recognition
right.
that Congress can
give right.
an individual or a military unit.
Right.
And this is going along very well. So mom, dad, if you're listening to this,
right.
pick up the phone, call your congressman, call your senator, and tell them, hey, I'm joining Gumercindo Gomez on getting that recognition for that regiment. Because they deserve it. They were veterans, and they did their job very well, very well. And in what we're doing right now, there's quite a few things, and that's why I can't retire.
I see. You're like, you know, retire this year? No, too many things going on.
I can't retire. Right now, we're trying to put together a 30-unit apartment next to this building here for homeless, needy veterans.
Oh, my gosh. That's amazing.
And the money's in the works.
Sure,
and
sure.
And we're trying to get the city to assist us with some funding.
Sure.
If when this happens, we will open a 3-story building here with 30 apartments for needy veterans. They can stay there for life.
Oh my!
It'll be permanent housing for them.
That's amazing. Because I hear about, you know, personally about veterans that are having difficulties finding job, and so thus finding housing. And so when you talk about living there for life, you're saying that even if you may not have a job, you'll have housing. Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm saying.
That is amazing. And so, again, that's a testament to your passion and your commitment to
these
veterans.
Because we're connected with the VA, what is called VA Hot Fosh.
Okay.
And the VA the federal will pay this individual 70% of their rent, mm-hmm. and they just have to come up with 30%. It'll be like a Section 8 for them.
Sure.
Definitely it will work out. The other piece that we're creating is in Pine Street, we're putting together a 10-room apartment house, single-room occupancy.
Okay.
And this hopefully will be open soon, and here a veteran can stay in those rooms for the rest of her life, of their life, mm-hmm. again. And they'll share bathrooms, and they'll share living areas, mm-hmm. and they'll share a kitchen and laundry room, mm-hmm. but they can remain there as long as they want or until they can move to another location, mm-hmm. which is bigger, more favorable to them.
Right.
The other piece that I'm working with, the YMCA.
Wonderful.
And the VA.
The VA in Northampton.
In Northampton, Director Roger Johnson.
Yes.
I'm trying to create a PT platoon, physical training platoon.
Okay.
Now, VA has a program already in place where they're working with the veterans who are obese, how they can work to lose weight and better their health.
Okay.
Now, if I add with the director of the YMCA, Mr. Donald Mitchell, great individual.
Yes, he is.
Homegrown here in the city.
He sure is, and I know Donald Mitchell myself, too. He's actually part of LPV, which is a Leadership Powder Valley program that I'm involved in, and he's an outstanding representation of leadership, emerging leaders.
Let me tell you what that man did. He came to this office and said, Vincenzo, I want to work with you.
Wonderful. See,
I want to work with you.
Absolutely.
Why? Because he's patient. He's passionate. Just like I am.
Yes.
And he wants to do something for our veteran.
Sure.
So it clicked in my head. I said, Donald, let's go to the fiscal. That's what you offer.
Right.
So we're trying to put these pieces together so we can attract veterans who need physical conditions.
Sure.
Work with them, better their health, their health, getting them integrated into the Y, and with an instructor who be a veteran, whoever that instructor might be. I volunteer myself. I was a drill sergeant.
Wait a minute. I think you should just come to the class. How about that? You do so much, you know, let someone else do that. But that makes sense. I mean, fitness, health, nutrition, I mean, they really need to make sure that they have those capacities, right? They have that understanding on what they need to do once they get back here in America, because it's a whole different. I mean, I can't even imagine being away from your family, not having a home-cooked meal, not being able to do, you know, exercise on a daily basis, let alone, you know, one day a week. And so for you to partner with organizations like the YMCA of Greater Springfield that make a difference, right, make an impact, you know, they're in 14 cities and towns, they do this work, and so it just makes sense. It really does. So
the great piece about this is if we get our veterans and give them a better health level,
sure,
the VA save money,
right,
federal save money. We save money.
Of course. They don't have to worry about going to the doctors, to the dentist, because they're eating well, they're feeling good, and so they can just live their life. You're right.
So we're just not helping the veteran. Mm-hmm. We're helping all of us.
Absolutely.
All of us. Less expenditures within federal government, and we help our president. Lord bless the president.
That's right. Our president, Barack Obama. Yeah. And now he's Dr. Barack Obama. He got an honorary doctorate from Morehouse College this past weekend, so
all right.
He's doctor.
this is our job.
Yes.
Now, one piece that I'm very strict with, veteran, don't you come in here and try to put one over my head.
Oh.
See, because I have heard them all.
Mm-hmm.
And some veterans will make up a story in their minds and they'll believe this.
Sure.
And they'll come here and say, Gomercindo, I want to put in for this.
Right.
Never was there in that theater of operation. Whatever did happen to him did not happen in military services. But they'll try this.
Interesting.
And it's our responsibility, it's my responsibility to ensure.
Right.
That I safeguard the treasure of this state of ours and the treasure of the United States of America. That's my responsibility. My responsibility, because those are my tax dollars, your tax dollars, everybody
else's
tax dollars. And we can't afford to go around and doing dirty work for somebody just to put money in their pocket. Sorry, but that's the way it is.
Right, right. No, I hear you. I mean, that's with any social organization. You know, you want to make sure that you're giving it to the people that actually need it, not for the people that are abusing it or manipulate it or connive, you know. So you're giving it to the people that need it, and they need to document that. You have to know exactly why, and that's understandable.
You'd be surprised the story I have heard.
I can imagine. I've got children. They tell me lots of stories. Especially my little one. But so this is great. So why don't we transition a little bit with the conversation to talk a little bit about, you know, we talked a little bit about it in the beginning of the show, about Memorial Day. And I know growing up in the city of Springfield, going through the public school system, you know, this was a big time for May. You know, we had, we would go to parades, we would do special occasions at school, we would make announcements. A veteran would actually come to our school and speak to us about, you know, their experience in the war. And so tell me, present day, 2013, how are we going to celebrate the impact and the significance of veterans from past wars and current wars that are going on right now?
First, if we are free, if we are free, you thank a veteran.
Right.
You thank a veteran. Mm-hmm. Memorial Weekend, Memorial Day, is a selective time that federal government has chosen to give thanks, not to us veterans who are still alive, mm-hmm. but for those that gave what they had the most. Mm-hmm. They gave their life in our defense,
right.
for my freedom.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a few. They were with me in Vietnam. And didn't come back alive. Mm-hmm. And this is time when I remember mm-hmm. their sacrifices. Mm-hmm. So I say, be grateful.
Right.
Be grateful. It's not about picnics. Mm-hmm. It's not about swimming. Mm-hmm. It's not about that.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, it can be integrated within the festivity.
Right.
But do make sure that within this weekend, at some time, at some place, mm-hmm. there will be a celebration. Mm-hmm. And that you make that celebration part of you. Right now in Springfield, mm-hmm. it'll happen this Friday mm-hmm. at 12 o'clock in front of City Hall.
Okay.
Then on Monday at 9 o'clock at St. Michael's Cemetery.
Mm-hmm.
And at 11:30 back in Springfield.
Mm-hmm.
On Saturday, there'll be a celebration over in East Hampton at the Harley Davidson's Motorcycle Club.
Oh,
we are going to be there.
Wonderful.
To give out services and to give thanks to those that are not here with us, but they gave the best they had, their lives.
Excellent. So why don't we stop and just pause for a few minutes, and we'll be right back with the Yana Crawford Show Inside Excellence.
I don't know what it's like.
I don't know what it's like.
I don't know what it's like to be in a war.
To be so far away from my family.
I don't know what it's like.
I don't know what it's like.
I don't know what it's like to
be the one who stays home.
But I do know this.
No matter how patriotic
you are
or how loving you are, being in a military family,
it can be harder than anyone knows.
If you're feeling at a loss, you're not alone.
There's help.
If you need to talk to someone,
please call this number.
It's confidential and free.
Your family needs you. We need you.
Thank you for your service.
I will be coming up on retirement, and the VA benefits will play a very important part in my life.
You may have earned valuable veterans benefits from your military service.
I decided that it was time to go to college and pursue my career.
I was able to buy this house.
Learn more about your eligibility, even how to apply online using e-benefits.
The VA benefits made a real difference in my life.
I wouldn't be where I am today if it hadn't have been for my VA benefits.
Don't wait. Apply for your VA benefits today.
I was the first woman ever to deploy on a Strategic Air Command deployment.
You didn't just serve your country.
I lobbied for women to be on board submarines.
You paved the way for others.
I joined the Army because I wanted a challenge.
and the challenges you face now? Your VA delivers a variety of benefits. Learn more, including how to apply online using eBenefits.
No matter what time it is, you've earned them. Apply today.
They inspire our service members and bring life into our military communities. They're strong, caring, and resilient. They don't always wear a uniform, but their service to the nation is selfless. This month, we recognize the integral role military families serve as they provide unwavering support to the men and women that protect our freedom. In November, join the U.S. Army Installation Management Command as we celebrate National Military Family Appreciation Month.
Welcome back to the Yana Crawford Show Inside Excellence. We're here with Guma Sanu Gomez, the Executive Director for the Veterans Outreach Center in Mass. Welcome.
Well, thank you. we're back here, and there's but a few areas that are probably we need to talk about for the benefit of our audience.
Absolutely. So as we end our last segment, and so I thought maybe you could talk about, as we were talking prior to the break, about this whole idea of the intake and what that looks like for veterans that come here and want services.
Well, just like they say in your job as a school teacher, mm-hmm. it takes a village to raise a child.
That's right.
It takes a city to help a veteran.
Yes.
When the veteran gets here to us, there's a few items that he needs with him. Mm-hmm. The first item that he needs is his discharge paper, which is called the DD-214.
Okay.
This is the paper that says what type of services he received, be honorable, dishonorable, other than honorable, how much time he served in the military, and where did he ended up within the military.
Okay.
This is a brief history of his services. Mm-hmm. To do anything, we have to establish that this individual is a veteran.
Mm.
Who's a veteran? An individual that has served at least 180 days continuously in active duty, or 90 days plus 1 day in a theater of war. And then if he is discharged before then, he's still considered a veteran. A National Guard or Reserve individual who was activated for military training, active duty, and served 180 days or again 90 plus 1 day. This would establish you as a veteran. We need, if you're coming in for a claim, we need to have to ensure that we can justify that claim, that you have proof, doctors, paperwork, you have documents that this happened in military services. If you got a kid who is in military services right now, parents, listen to me, and you get a chance to talk to your kid, make sure he documents, she documents everything that happens to him, her, while they are still in uniform, because when they get out, that's going to be very beneficial for them. Now, as we develop our work here with the veteran, we're going to be talking to the VA, regional VA. We're going to be talking to the VA in Boston. We're going to be sending this individual to Mr. Tom Belton, Director of Veteran Services in Springfield.
Who runs
the Chapter 115, because that's the department that is going to put dollars in that veteran's pocket if he ain't got a job or ain't got no money at all. And of course, this is temporary, but it's there for their needs. We're going to be talking to the housing department in trying to find a place where this individual can go. If he wants education, we're going to be talking to the colleges, referring him and networking with colleges to ensure that this kid gets into college and get what he wants. So there's definitely a lot of work that goes into helping this veteran, not just one guy, not just us here. And we have at least 6-7 employees here. But there's a lot of areas that we cannot do here. But we are the funnel. We get you out there to where you need to go, with a telephone call or a letter saying, we're sending you Joe for your help.
Right.
And that helps a lot.
Wonderful.
In services.
Nice. So I'm curious. I know a lot of times we think of veterans as men, right? And what happens to the women vets that come back that may have had children, may have been, you know, a wife, and so they're coming back. How does their services or their issues differ from men that come back from the service?
The woman has many issues that many times they do not want to talk to men. They don't feel comfortable talking to men. That's why Gumercindo got smart. Gumercindo got two female veterans in the office.
Nice. Wonderful. Did you hear that, audience?
There's two
female veterans that can deal with women's issues, and you can feel comfortable to be able to talk to women.
Definitely. We got Miss Betty Ball Borders. Miss Betty Borders served in the Air Force, and she was a captain for 16 years.
Wow.
And we got Miss Evelyn Martinez, who served for 6 years in the Army. And both of them are here specifically to work with veterans, female veterans. While I was in military services, I had the ability and the chance to work with many female veterans, especially in training as a drill sergeant. And a veteran is a veteran, but a female veteran and a male veteran, two different individuals with different issues, different feelings, and you have to know how to work with them. We got a lot of female veterans who are hiding. Female veteran, if you see this, don't hide. Come over here. We want to help you.
That's right. You hear that? You're hearing it here on the Yana Carpet Show. It makes sense because women have, like you said, there's different issues. And so how can we help them to understand or recognize that this may just not be some ordinary thing that's going on with them?
You know,
it may be a post-traumatic stress that they have based on being in war. And so how can they recognize that?
The biggest issue is the sexual attack that she had received in service. Because at least 20 to 30% of our female who have served have been sexually abused. I don't know if you have had a chance to read the news nowadays, how this is coming out. I do receive the Army Times every week, and I'm able to read the charges that are placed over senior NCOs, generals, abusing females. So it's a big thing, and many, many females up to keep it to themselves, but the vet center, federal vet center, has a female counselor in these issues.
Okay.
And we can locate, and we can put you in place, we can service connect you with PTSD, because definitely you got PTSD for what happened to you.
Sure.
Don't keep it to yourself. The more you keep it to yourself, the more you're gonna hurt. The more you're gonna hurt.
Right, and not even hurt yourself, but your family.
Exactly.
You know, because they care about you and they want to see you successful. So I think it's important, women that are veterans, to really come out, especially to this particular center here in Western Mass or in Mass, to really share your feelings. And I think sometimes when we share our feelings, it helps with the healing, right?
Definitely. It has to come out. PTSD has to come out. What happened to you has to, you have to talk to somebody.
Right.
And like we say before, we have two beautiful female veterans here, dedicated. They're just like myself, from the heart,
right.
and they just want to sit down with you and help you in all areas, and not just that, those areas, any area that you feel you need help with, the kids, housing, jobs, we can help with that.
Wow, that's magnificent. So why don't we give the address and the phone number again for this center and any other centers that you want to kind of mention to our listening and our audience out in the TV land?
Well, definitely. And because I know you can't remember this, you better get something to write with.
Yeah, why don't you take a few seconds and go get a pen and paper?
You ain't got a computer in your head.
Right, right.
But again, the address is 281 Franklin Street in Springfield. The telephone number is 413-731-0194. Our website, bilingualvets.org. If you go into the website, You have all the information that you need, and you'll be able to understand exactly what we do here, because the whole history is there. Thank you to somebody that we know very much, Mr. Nate Patterson.
Oh yes, Mr. Nate Patterson, he's a great guy.
This guy been tagging along with me for many years.
Wonderful.
And he is the one that keeps this organization on top, in videos, on the web, and the information out there. So I want to thank that individual.
Absolutely. For the work that he does. Go ahead and thank him right now.
Oh yeah, he's in front of us. Thank you, Nate.
But no, thank you so much. I think it's been an honor, and of course, a pleasure to have you here on the show. You're a decorated soldier, passionate individual for our community, especially for the Hispanic Puerto Rican community. I think you are just a wonderful asset to Springfield, and I think more people that are looking to partner with you, help the veterans, help people heal from PTSD, this is the man to really help to work with, because he's got the passion and the commitment for all of Springfield. That's what I have come to learn throughout this show today. And so again, I thank you so much for coming on our show. I look forward to partnering with you if there's anything that I can do as an educator in terms of getting the word out about veterans and helping the community understand that we've got to support them as they come home. I'm more than happy to do that. And again, thank you so much for joining us here on the Yana Crawford Show, Inside Excellence.
Thank you.
Brothers and sisters,
in researching this film,
there have been some
disturbing assertions,
some misconceptions,
some half-truths,
some outright lies.
So we felt the need
to set the record straight.
Some of you have said
more black men,
18 to 24,
are in jail,
that are in college.
Some of you have said
one out of two
black men
does not
graduate high school.
Some of you have said
one out of three
black men is incarcerated. Total black men.
Some of you have said
most black women dying of AIDS
contracted it from
down low black men.
50% of black women
have died from AIDS,
from IV drug use
or sex
with an IV drug user.
The time has come
for you to question
everything you know about black men.
You have been duped.
You have been took,
hoodwinked,
bamboozled,
led astray,
run amok,
hustled,
misinformed,
misled,
had the wool pulled over your eyes.
So the next time
you hear a statistic,
do us a favor,
check the source,
investigate,
validate,
before you reiterate,
it just might be
another lie
about black men.
Thank you.
so civil about war anyway?
What we've got here is failure to communicate. Some men you just can't reach. So you get what we had here last week, which is the way he wants. Well, he gets. I don't like it.
Look at your women crying, look at your young men dying, the way they've always done before.
Us here.
Bilingual Veterans Outreach Center, can I help you out?
This is the Ayanna Crawford Show, Inside Excellence, saying goodbye to a...